Thanks to everyone for joining our webinar today. We are going to talk today about how Fast4 can help with automatically reconciling your online payments in NetSuite. And before we get started, just one short administrative note. We have a separate colleague of ours today monitoring the questions. So in your Zoom, you should be able, in the middle below, you should see a Q&A functionality. If you have questions on anything we're showing today, just use that functionality and we will try to answer those straight away. If we have lots of questions left or if there's additional questions, we should still have plenty of time at the end of the session also to go over those. For today, we split the topic into four areas. I'll start with a very short introduction. Then we're going to zoom in on what we mean with this term PSP processes. We'll have a look together how we solve that in NetSuite. And that part of the webinar will also contain a live product demonstration. And after that, we'll come back and then I'll give some final pointers and informations on the tooling we use for these processes. So let's start with a brief introduction. So I'm joined on the webinar today by my colleague, Teresa. Teresa is a solution consultant at Fast4, product expert on pretty much all our apps. She will be performing the live product demonstration today. And the guy on the left here, that's me. I'm sales director at Fast4. And before I took this role, I also worked as a couple of years as a NetSuite implementation consultant. Predominantly did e-commerce projects, and what we're discussing today was always quite a hot topic during these projects. For those of you on the webinar who are completely new to Fast4, a very short introduction. So we are an SDN partner for NetSuite, founded in 2014, and since 2014, We have over 500 customers around the world that use one of our suite apps. And one of the things that's still the same since day one is that we only focus on NetSuite. All our apps are completely native suite apps, meaning that they are a seamless part of your NetSuite setup. And today we're really going to focus on a use case or a solution that we offer, and we'll focus the story on an e-commerce use case. And if you look at NetSuite for e-commerce, that traditionally has been a really good fit, like a lot of large, fast-growing e-commerce companies use NetSuite. And I found this image online, and I thought it's like a nice starting point to sort of sum up why that is and what NetSuite offers these customers. So here you can see that entire scope of the solution. And for me, NetSuite does the basics really well. So the financials, there's really good basic inventory management. But also if companies grow beyond that, there's a lot of features available. So if you look at the bottom right, supply chain management, the company's grows if they need things like MRP or some automation around replenishment management, NetSuite has that covered. And then on top of that, if you look at the bottom there, it says integrations, and that's also something NetSuite does really well. And looking at the e-commerce projects that I've done, always multiple systems are used, right? So we'll mention the web shop software a few times today, but also think of sales channels, marketing tools. NetSuite handles that really strongly. And every e-commerce company is also a data-driven company, and also there with the report capabilities that NetSuite offers. You get a great complete package and you have all those insights in the same system where you also do your operational processes. And because of that great fit, you see that NetSuite has a really strong customer database within e-commerce. And we were also lucky enough to be able to work with some of those. So if you look at the logos here, all companies that deal with the issues we're discussing today and all companies where our solution is running. So the one that we'll be giving you a demo of during the webinar today. So let's zoom out and let's look at what we mean with this term. So we've been promoting this webinar also under the term PSP reconciliation. I thought it was good to give a little bit of context there. So PSP stands for payment service providers. And I've included a few of the most famous ones on the right here. You probably will recognize at least a couple of those. And those payment service providers, they facilitate the online payments for e-commerce companies. And the reason why we need those parties is that the world of online payment gets quite complex. Yeah, like every different market has their own unique payment methods that you need to support to be successful. Like I'm based out of Amsterdam. So if you have a web shop here in the Netherlands, you better support iDEAL as a payment method. If you were doing that in Germany, yeah, you better support something like Klarna. And to build your own integrations with all of those, it's not really feasible. So that's where these service providers come in. And the way that works is that they usually connect to the web shop platform. When a customer purchases a product, as part of that checkout process, there is a connection made with that payment service provider. The payment service provider collects the payment, make sure that the details of those payments are stored in the web shop software. And from the web shop software, that is then synced to the ERP back office system. What then happens is that the payment service providers would usually have collected that money, that's on their account, and they pay that out to the individual web shops in batches. And then based on the volume involved, that's done in weekly or sometimes in daily payment batches. Now, good to note here that even though we're talking about e-commerce most of the times, it's not the only industry we see that in. There's a few more. Like we also have quite some customers in the hospitality industry or in the retail industry that deal with the exact same process. They might not then use web shop software to capture those payments. It can be a POS system, point of sale system, but really the same process is in place. And what we found for our customers is that within that process, they had a few common challenges. And I summarized those into two. So what we saw in that process is that on an individual transaction level, the insights into how this was paid were there, but whether that money was actually collected on the bank account, that was not something that they could see immediately on the transactions in the ERP system. And what they ended up doing a lot of the time during the monthly close period is that there would be a manual reporting process in which they would look at specifications from those PSP providers, compare those with the transactions in their ERP, do an Excel exercise, and then try to get some overview on that. And we figured that there had to be a better way to tackle that. So let's have a look at how we solve that for our customers with our tooling in NetSuite. And I tried to summarize that on this overview. A lot of things happening, but I'll talk you through that step by step. So if you look at the upper layer here, that's the process that I just described, right? So the customer who goes online pays for a transaction. That is then synced to the ERP system. That contains the PSP reference. So this is the unique transaction ID that the payment service provider allocates to that transaction. And that then creates a matching transaction and a matching payment status in NetSuite. And I deliberately use the term transaction here. So if I jump ahead one slide, I think this table shows our secret sauce for this, or what I think really makes our solution so good, is that that process can be configured in NetSuite in quite a few different ways for customers. So if the customer sells services or a digital product online, they might straight away create an invoice. If they sell physical goods, so there's also a shipping process, most likely they'll create a sales order, right? So that they can also do the full fulfillment process in NetSuite. And then even within those options, there can still be a difference. Sometimes the customer might want to already record a transaction for the payment. Sometimes they might not. So there's a lot of different ways in which that can be done. And with our tooling, we are flexible enough to really support all those different setup scenarios, which we'll also show you during the demo in a moment. So if I go back here, you look at this blue layer here, this is the functionality that we add with our application. So we allow the customer to import the detailed report from the PSP provider. And so those are statement specifications where they say, this batch that we paid out related to these individual transactions. We import that into our tooling. Our tooling then matches that to the relevant transaction in NetSuite. And based on the scenario or the setup there, we make sure we take the right payment reconciliation and the right payment impact also for their setup. And by doing that process, it means we go from the challenges we had before to now we get a full reconciliation overview. So on every transaction, we can see exactly what the deposit status is. We have that up to date. So it's not something we do monthly. And we can configure that to be a fully automated process as well. So with that as the introduction and the context, I suggest we go and we have a look at how that works in NetSuite. So Teresa, I'll put myself on mute. I'll give the word to you to give us the product demonstration.
Perfect. Thank you, Jurriaan. So I will start by sharing my screen. If you are not able to see the detail, make sure that you unpin the window of Jurriaan. And hopefully everybody is able to see my NetSuite environment where I'm logged in as an admin and I have our application installed over there. So first I would like to explain what has been set up in the background so that the full reconciliation process can be running. So I will start by showing you how my setup of chart of account looks. So in here, I'm going to have three separate accounts. So the first one I'm going to use is the actual bank account where the payout from the service provider will be deposited. So as Jurriaan said, this will be done irregularly and usually in lump sum payments. The second account I will use today is the actual statement or account where I will be reconciling my PSP provider statement. So I saw somebody mentioning in the chat Braintree, PayPal, or the other providers that you are working with. And we treat them as a bank account. Why we are doing it? Because we need to make sure that all those underlying transactions that are on this account are also going to balance out on the third account that we will use to close the reconciliation process. So the third account we will use in our equation is a clearing account, which is not considered a bank account for our use case because we don't want to be limited by one currency or one subsidiary. So three accounts, two of them will be configured, and to those we will be uploading the statements with transactions on it. And on this third account, at the end of the demo, we will see that these balance out. In terms of setup of our tool, I will just briefly show you what is really important or what specifics do we take into consideration when reconciling PSP providers. So on this page, you will see that we have some predefined bank file formats. And when it comes to PSP service providers, we already expect the way the data is structured. So you will see some predefined formats for provider like Adyen, or already mentioned PayPal or any other. Should you work with some new provider and we don't have a template for it, we would only ask you to configure your PSP provider account the same way you do with banks. And this time you will best know what type of data is the best as a matching preference. So we will be looking at things like descriptions. We would be looking at things that would tell us if that transaction represents a debit or a credit transaction. We know that a lot of customers would have a manual task of calculating the commissions and fees from this provider statement. For that, we have a built-in logic that if you would basically tell us which columns on your statements represent these fees, we would summarize them towards the end of the statement as one journal or one lump sum that you can then journal according to your needs. In Julian's overview, you saw that we are able to work with undeposited transactions, undeposited cash sales, or undeposited payments that were basically integrated and pushed through the integration with the provider. Should it be your case, all we would need is to know to which account these transactions were linked to, so that we can take care of the correct posting, meaning depositing those payments to the correct bank account. In terms of matching preferences, we have several options, but the strongest one that is usually used and introduced with PSP statements is the matching on the so-called open or closed logic. So an example of a closed transaction, open transaction would be an invoice where Fast4 will generate a payment after we saw the payment actually deposited. Or we would basically treat a cash sale that was already deposited as a closed transaction. The way we do it and the way we found is most effective if we use the document number itself. So if a particular sales order is mentioned, we can find it pretty easily, or we can extend the logic to additional parameters. And that's most of the time the case. So on the additional parameter setup, what you can tell us is the name, the ID, the parameter that your provider is using. And we are expecting that the underlying transaction we are linking to will have this as a reference, where on the transaction itself, in the header part, somewhere as a custom field. Let me show you an example. Maybe that is going to make more sense if I just open one of my customers. And in here, we will see that I have several transactions open or already deposited. And the payments itself, we have a look at this payment that is already deposited. We can also have a look at one which is not deposited. So these payments that came through the integration have these PSP references. So all I need to see in the statement from the provider is this number. It will disregard the other matching preferences are also available, but this would be the strongest way of matching to this one-on-one transaction. Same logic would be here with an undeposited payment. So what we are going to do next, because we have the setup, we have those three accounts, we have our configuration up and running. So the task that is actually performed is the upload. And Yura mentioned that we have the option of doing this step manually, or there's also a room for better automation. I will walk you through all the options. So the most basic option is just going to bank reconciliation, importing the statement. We have two options, either the single import or multiple import. I will start with the import of multiple. Reason being is that typically what we expect is that your statements are going to include a lot of data. So what we would like to offer you is a basically option to split it by volume so that you have less transaction to review by every single page. It's still the same account you're reconciling. It's just for better user experience, we would limit it. So what I mean by it, if I had a statement of 2000 lines, we can say the transactions per statement should be split by 500. And therefore, if I upload such a long statement, it would offer me four separate links. So my browser will work way faster and it's not going to take me so much time. I can just pause it. I can take things step by step. My statement has just 12 lines. Therefore, it's just one link, no need for any split, but it's good to know that we have the option of using the multiple import record in this way. So the PSP statement, we treat it, as I told you already, as a bank account. So I will be seeing some reporting in here. So first of all, the bank account is linked to a particular subsidiary. It is in one particular currency. The transaction overview, so this is a statement from last week. The start balances, same thing. In my demo accounts, I did not really pre-record any historic balance. In here, the debits and credits. So I will see that I have five lines that are debits, so some sort of charges. and 7 credit transactions appearing in here. Every single line represents the line from the statement compared against the transactions that we see in NetSuite. Most of them you will see have the yes box, meaning that we were successfully recognizing them. However, some of them might be empty. Maybe there is a mismatch or not sufficient reference, but I will show you how to fix it very easily, the line number 8, so that you can complete the whole statement into full reconciliation. So what we are looking at right now are all the use cases that we had in our presentation. So the first one is an actual invoice which is open. Again, how did we find the reference is either the transaction itself or that unique parameter. The scenario 2 is already a payment. This is pre-recorded. However, it can be perhaps undeposited, and our job is to deposit it to the correct account. Should the payment already be deposited, we would just make sure that we link that to this correct bank statement so that we have a link on that transaction leading back to this statement for further reconciliation. Line number 4 and 5 represent the scenario where we had companies that need to do fulfillment processes. So we are linking to actual sales orders. The sales orders, either we would record the deposits or we would link to the actual pre-recorded deposit that already exists. Scenario of cash sales. So these are, again, deposited or undeposited. The last one represents one debit line. So my assumption is that this is a refund. The easiest and the fastest way of fixing this line would be either searching through the name if you knew to which account this, this payment is linked to. In my use case, it's a generic cash sale. I don't really record the customer's names. So what I'm going to do is go through the pop-up, which offers me a transaction view. And on this transactional search, the best match based on the amount given are these following transactions. So since it was a debit, I'm going to link it to this particular transaction. The following lines are representing those additional fees. So again, if your provider is putting those fees as separate lines, you may see things like handling fees, merchant fees, shipping fees. We don't actually have any pre-recorded transaction or an account to link to. So the way I fix this is through an automatic selection of an account. I could also go one step further and have a rule which selects for me departments, classes, or locations. We call this functionality custom matching rule. And that's the easiest and fastest way of handling these regular charges occurring on your bank accounts or PSP statements. And I'm also using it for line 11, which is particularly important for my reconciliation process here, because this line is a summary, total summary of all the payouts. You will see that the summary line is not a credit, it's a debit that is posted to a clearing account. So from my overview, remember, it was that third account I will use to close up the reconciliation. The line 12 represents the total commission, the summary of all the columns that I would provide in my statement. And then the tool is calculating this as one lump sum for me. And again, with a custom matching rule, I can easily fix the posting of these charges. So what I'm going to do next is save the statement. What I'm hoping for is to see for every single line appropriate transaction to be either reconciled, updated, or created. In the meantime, while this is running, because this can be done in the background, and depending on the amount, you can just simply let it run, and you don't need to really stay on the page until everything has been generated. In the meantime, I'm going to do the second step, which is uploading the actual bank statement. So on this bank statement, I have only one line, and that one line represents the payout from my service provider. I will have a journal generated with this lump sum. And the total lump sum of this journal, I want to compare against all the payouts happening on the PSP's provider statement. So this line is not recognized yet. All I need to do is select the account, or if I wanted, I could have saved myself a job by creating the custom matching rule. So what I'm doing is posting a credit of this total payout and creating a journal. And on the other side, another journal will balance out the same amount. So let me show you this in practice. Journal, which is debiting my bank account and crediting the clearing account. On the previous statement, I have the very same amount. This time, representing a debit on the same. So if I click into here, which is the register of that third clearing account that I used at the beginning, is that I will see the balancing. So the way how we handle this most effectively is indeed through making sure that we have no extraordinary payments happening. And the best way that to handle it is through these auto matching rules that are helping us to post those lump sums to a third account called clearing account. So I showed you a manual import, but I also mentioned that there are other automated ways. So especially if you are dealing with high volume of transactions, most of our customers, they would use the so-called scheduled matching. So in this case, on the same setup page, like I showed you earlier, they would set bank statement for automatic processing. I have one for Adyen. So what it requires is a setup of two folders in your file cabinet. The one where the statements will be uploaded to by yourselves. So you would take the files, drag and drop it into your file cabinet folder. Then you will define a specific time of a day where the file will be automatically uploaded into our tool. And you can choose either to just automatically upload it where it's waiting for your review, or it will also automatically process them if you wish so. The moment we would be successfully processing them, they would be then pushed into a so-called process folder. So literally it's moving the statements from one folder to another after the full reconciliation process is done. Here you can define what type of folders we should be working on. If you wish all of them that you save in this folder, or you can limit them if not all of them should be worked up. But that's the one step further towards a more automated reconciliation process. Perfect. So I have done my reconciliation in full. I am happy with the results. So now back to Jurjan.
Perfect. Thank you, Teresa. Let me make sure I unmute myself. There we go. And everyone should be seeing my screen again. Let's wrap up. There's just a couple of additional slides that I want to highlight here. The first one is the technology behind the demo that Teresa just gave is our Bank Reconciliation Suite app. So if you're interested in these processes, reach out to us and know that this is the app that we should be discussing. And I wanted to share some sort of top level information on what a project for this app would look like. And then it's important to know that there can be two different scenarios here. So for those of you that are not yet working with our bank reconciliation app, this is what a timeline would look like. So I have 4 to 6 weeks implementations with the steps you can see on the screen here. And that would be a full implementation of the app. And as part of that, we can then also set up your PSP accounts. If you are already using BankRec, then that process is much lighter. It would require a little bit of additional setup. Most of that you can potentially also do yourself, but hey, you would need to configure some additional accounts, a few additional features that we need to configure for you. In that case, please reach out to us. we'll discuss your use case and then we can make an estimate on that. That's also a good note in general to mention when it comes to implementation. Like with this tooling, we support some of the largest NetSuite customers out there, and there can be a slight difference in how we set it up, how we run the matching to really make sure we optimize that for your concrete use case and your concrete volume. So especially for these PSP processes, we always really recommend to just reach out to us and have a conversation so we can give you concrete advice on it. In order to do that, you can use this email address, sweetapps@fast4.com. You can also use our contact forms on the website, mention that you're interested in PSP reconciliation. We'll make sure that ends up with the right person. And for those of you who joined a bit later, or in case some things might have gone a bit fast, we'll always send out a summary email afterwards that will contain a recording, so you can watch the intro and the live demonstration another time. So with that, I think I had a quick look at the Q&A, and I think that there were no open questions. I saw there's one still pending from Sean Charles. Sean Charles, there are two options. So in case that that total line is not showing on your statement report, there's also a second option where we can add that that line to the statement. We would use a script for that. Reach out to us if you want to have a concrete discussion on that. I don't think there's anything else pending. So then with that, guys, we'd really like to thank you for your time and for attending this webinar. As mentioned, reach out to us if you need any further information. Always happy to have a discussion. And we hope to welcome you also to our next webinar. And have a great rest of the day. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.